All right, we are live. Welcome, everybody. Welcome. We are joined today with our special guest, Squilla Killa. Got the usual hosts, myself, King Swam, and Slothanot.
I'm actually here, but I am hosting you, and I got a... I got to also retweet, I think, because it didn't work. For some reason, I clicked it, and it looked amazing. Like, it went through, and then it didn't work.
It happens.
Yeah, okay, one second. I'll be, like, just a moment.
Oops. We having tweet difficulties?
Well, I gave the host to, I had to spam the link and do the host, but yeah, I'm finishing the tweet right now. I'm almost ready.
I love some of these questions.
Now it showed up. Now we're good. I think everything's fine. I've done my job, right? Like, you guys paid me pretty well, but I did my job.
Yep. All right. You're good. You can take off.
All right. See you later.
So, are we ready?
I am good. I'm good to go.
I'm ready. I think Sloth had a super important question he wanted to start off with.
Yes, I do. So... something that's just been burning in my mind for quite a few months now, and I don't think I've ever heard the answer to, although you mentioned earlier that you have answered this question before. But for those of us who don't already know, what is a Squilla and why do you kill them?
Okay, so there is this one time where I was on a journey, and it was a long, hard journey in the Badlands of Edge, of course. Tumbleweeds rolling around, you know, like sandstorms and shit. Had a little bit of a shawl over my face, and then, you know, I looked up because I heard a sound, and it was a squilla crawling around. And it was a creature that kind of looked like a crab, shrimp, you know, something like that. Something like from the sea, maybe. And I stepped on it, and then I decided right there. Except for that's not true, and it was just my first PSN name when I was like 14. Because it wasn't taken by anybody. It was original.
I have a great follow-up question. and this is something that's been burning in my mind for the all 5 seconds that I've read it. What position do you sleep in?
Me? Kind of on my side.
Okay.
How do you feel about Kickflip Kid 540?
Oh my god, I can explain that. I can actually explain that. Okay, so that whole name is from when I skateboarded, because originally when I joined YouTube and stuff, a lot of the stuff I watched was skating related, and I was heavily skateboarding. And like even after that, you know, I stuck with it because I don't know, it was my interest. And yeah.
Wait, is that an actual name?
It's his YouTube URL.
That's my YouTube account name. I changed my YouTube URL after I hit the requirement for subs, but like it was my account name.
Before, so you're actually an edgelord. Okay, got it.
I've never done a 540 kickflip though, just so you know.
All right. So thank you for answering that. My my need to know is sated. So to jump right into things, for those of you who don't, or for those who don't already know you, Squilla, can you take a moment to introduce yourself?
Okay, so I do a lot of Souls challenges and have for a little bit. I was originally a PvP streamer, and that was cool. It was mostly on DS2. And I'm sure everyone's familiar with Souls that are here because they're probably interested in that. But if you're not, it is a good game. Check it out. And I stream a lot of Soul stuff. That's what I do.
Awesome. Thank you. So jumping right into things, what inspired you to start making content, and what has your experience as a content creator been, and how has it changed over time?
Originally, it was the whole idea that when I was kind of like a guest, or just I'd say like a regular viewer on channels, like my first experience wasn't that great because the interactivity wasn't really there with a lot of channels that I wanted to interact with. Like even just saying simple things like hi, or like what's going on, or asking a question would rarely get answered from a select amount of people that I was watching. And then it was when I found channels that started actually, you know, kind of giving more of a shit about new people and like, you know, being fair to everybody and giving like a good positive, you know, amount of feedback on certain things. Like that was when I was like, okay, maybe this would be a cool idea for me to try, so I can maybe find other people that PvP and like have like good PvP instead of just random PvP, like fight clubs and organized things. People, you know, can learn from it. Maybe I can learn from other people. That was the reason for starting. And then like since then, like what's changed is basically just like a huge amount of knowledge has been absorbed from like just how the platform works and just how to like, you know, like going from just doing something as like a hobby to like full-time as well is a very big progression. So a lot of information in the process of that.
Sure. You mentioned that you started with Dark Souls 2 PvP. How were you first introduced to the Souls series, and what did you think of it coming in as a new player?
Okay, the story with the introduction to Souls is pretty funny, actually. It was completely just a random chance. It was something that, like, I knew of, I had heard of. I had never actually seen it. Like, no one I knew had showed me it. But I did have a friend that had talked about it. And I remember me and this friend and, like, my other friend, we were having a conversation one day. And he was like, don't play this game. It's really, really hard. It's really bad. Like, you'll hate it. Like, because we were just going over like a bunch of stuff that he had recently tried, and he was saying that was one of the things that he doesn't recommend and not to get it. So that's the only time I had heard about it at that point. Like the first
was someone telling you not to play it.
Yeah, someone saying it's just really bad. Like just don't play it. It's really hard. So like it didn't even really appeal to me because I wasn't someone that just would play something because it's hard or anything. I was into a lot of like a variety of stuff, but a lot of stuff like, you know, popular games that a lot of people would like, you know. So it came down to, like, I remember one day me and, like, the other person that was my friend in that situation when we were talking in a group, we went to, like, try to find something that was multiplayer that we could get, and we just went to the store together, and, like, he actually found Demon's Souls. He ended up, like, leaving with that, and I found Two Worlds, which is really shitty. I didn't like it. It was very bad. And I remember, like, we went back to his house, like, right away, and he was playing Demon's Souls. He's like, let's just check this out. And he was like, dude, this is like really hard. What the hell? And he was freaking out about it. And I'm like, can I try? And I'm like, yeah, like this is nonsense. And I made so many excuses of why it was bad and like why they weren't good at like making games or this or that. It just, I just trash talked it pretty much. And then I didn't like Two Worlds enough to keep it. So I brought it back and I saw there was one last copy. And I asked the dude, is this like the last one you guys have in Demon's Souls? Because it did have multiplayer. So I'm like, maybe we could co-op. And he's like, yeah. So I changed it for that game, and then I started playing Demon's Souls and got a little bit further, like progressed in it, and it was actually a good feeling, so I continued it, and then it ended up being the best game I played ever at that point, and it took over a month to complete on and off.
I had kind of a similar story with how I got into Dark Souls, because I used to use GameStop as like a rental service. Get a used game, return it in 7 days, full money back.
Like I played. Oh, you're one of those people.
yep, one of those people. And I remember I had just played Mass Effect 2 and beat it, loved it, returned it. And I just grabbed the first Dark Souls and fell in love, didn't end up returning it, kept it forever.
My story is pretty funny. I was watching PewDiePie play it. And I was like, oh, this looks cool. And then it was free on Xbox Live Arcade. And I was like, oh, well, fuck it. Might as well try it. And here I am.
And I wanted to ask, too, at what point in your streaming did you transition from Dark Souls 2 PvP into no-hit running? Like, did you do Dark Souls 3 PvP at all before you started doing that, or...?
Okay, so basically it started off as Dark Souls 2 vanilla on PC. And there's a whole nother situation. I can explain so many funny things to do with, like, why it was such a struggle, like, with the setup and the hardware. But it was, like, a very low-quality stream, right? So I PvP'd on PC in, like, the lowest settings. It was, like, in windowed mode and stuff like that. So it was still good. It was the only way I could stream it. It was a really bad setup. But it was bridge PvP mostly. So Iron Keep. Invasions and
the bridge was where it was at, man.
Yeah, it was when the bridge was like on the come up, man. Like, it was when it was super, super hype, right? And then I just like being on the bridge a lot, and then kind of started invading in different areas. Then I started doing arena after that, but it was mostly that kind of stuff. And the transition from PvP to PvE and doing challenges was when I was at like the point of like PvP had like its highest point. It was at the peak in DS2 of popularity, and like there was people so good that like you could say they were like world class, like they were the best players in the world. And I had a chance to play with a lot of those people. Like, you probably know names if you were into it, like Scorebrand, Lyrical Assassin,
yeah,
Apkoa, Jimmy, Jimmy Fender. I think his name's Jimmy Fender. You know, people like
Rando
that.
Got good.
Yeah, like, and then there was other people after that I could drop names of, but, like, mostly those were the people I was playing with, and they were just so much better than everybody that I got, like, decent from learning from them and became kind of friends with them. And then that's, like, when we kind of got to the realization that it was only really good if we were playing with people that good, right? Like, because if someone was going to lose, like, guaranteed, or they were going to do some, like, scrubby tactics to win at any cost just because they didn't want to lose, but, like, instead, like, we wanted to learn, it wasn't worth it unless we had someone that wanted to learn as well. So we kind of just got lost interest and it got stale. And then everybody kind of faded off at the same time with that. So I found a lot of... you know, excitement in doing a challenge or doing something that's challenging that was only up to myself to improve on and not someone else. It only involved me. So I like that a lot more.
That's why I kind of started doing PvP as well back in the day. And Dark Souls 2 was like, PvP was at its prime for that, just because of the amount of variety you had with creating builds. Like, I have some old footage of yours up right now of one of your poison builds in Dark Souls 2. And it's just like, that's the kind of shit that, like, that wouldn't fly in Dark Souls 3 at all.
Yeah, it was so much different, but, like, I loved the PvP in DS2. It was, that time in gaming was just, like, one of the best. It's very memorable. So many cool things, like, during that time.
Yeah,
go ahead, sorry.
Dark Souls 2 PvP was the highlight of the series for me in so many ways, and I think the main thing about it, if I like really sit down to think about it, that I like the most about Dark Souls 2 PvP, at least in its heyday, was the fact that basically all of the schools of magic were viable, and a lot of different kinds of weapons were viable. And you could come up with almost any kind of build and make it work in PvP. Whereas in Dark Souls 3, you're kind of pigeonholed into a few strategies and weapon classes. And if you aren't using one of those, you are at a huge disadvantage in the PvP setting. I mean, magic in Dark Souls 3 PvP is basically completely useless. Whereas in Dark Souls 2, if you used it well, you would destroy people. I think that the wide variety of builds and weapons and schools of magic that you saw in Dark Souls 2 is part of what made it so special. So
it had a lot of variety too. It had some of the largest variety when it came to weapons, in terms of like, even though something could be kind of like just a reskin, it was all about like the style of it. Like, it had such a nice appeal for variety in terms of style with armor and weapons and all that stuff.
Yeah, it was the golden age of Dark Souls PvP, in my opinion. Yeah. If FromSoft ever make another Soulsborne title, I hope that we have PvP that's on the level of Dark Souls 2 in its heyday, because that was really just a special time to be playing, it felt like.
I would want it to be in the Dark Souls 1 or 3 engine, but have it have the variety of Dark Souls 2. That's what I would really like. And have the PvE of Bloodborne. So that's a high calling, I guess. But that's the only game that I really want from software to make. If they're going to make a new From, or if they're going to make a new Bloodborne or Dark Souls game, I'd want it to be like the best of all worlds, or for them to fuck off and just make like Armored Core or whatever new stuff.
Yeah, I was talking about that earlier, actually, before when we were testing audio settings. Speaking of which, before I even get to that, is the audio okay? Like, people were saying in chat that my audio is robotic. Does it sound like that to you guys?
It fades in and out. Like, you sound fine now.
Okay, because I keep, like, resetting. I keep doing the thing you were telling me to do earlier with, like, going to default and then switching back. But, yeah, I have no idea. My Discord's not cooperative for some reason. I don't know.
Canadian Discord.
Yeah, Canadian RNG, man. Discord. And anyways, yeah, I was saying, like, I'm sure they're going to take consideration when deciding on what to do with PvP. They're going to take all the elements into consideration of what made all of the PvP good before. And obviously, if it's not the same people for B Team that did DS2, some of that stuff might not be included. But I think they have the ability to make decent PvP if it's not B Team. I know that. So I'm sure if they have multiplayer in the next thing, it's not going to be a train wreck. And it's not going to be worse than everything that exists before.
There are a lot of there are a lot of different factors for them to consider when they're trying to make a new game and balance the PvE and the PvP, because there are certain weapons that might be really strong in PvP and not very good in PvE, and vice versa. So finding a balance between those two is a challenge, certainly. You mentioned earlier that you kind of stopped PvPing when a lot of the other community members dropped Dark Souls 2 as well. Did your change into doing challenge runs start prior to the release of Dark Souls 3, or?
Oh yeah, yeah. It definitely did. It was okay. It started actually on Scholars. So like, I started doing like SL1 and Deathless. Mainly, like, I had tried challenges a little bit before Scholar had come out on the original DS2, but I did not get into them as much, and I didn't even complete SL1. Actually, I did SL1 and it was incomplete. So it was the first time I came back to SL1, and I actually beat every single thing in the game SL1, and then I went on to NG+, then NG+2, and did DLCs and stuff like that. And like, and I actually think Laron was there for some of that, and I think I don't know if he's here right now. I think he might be in chat, but he would remember. And that was actually some of the best times as well, because it wasn't really like so reset heavy. And it's not that I don't like resets these days. I don't mind them, but it was like SL1 was still like super, super exciting for me to just do like that, and it was new. So it was a really cool time as well.
My first challenge run in Souls was SL1 as well, and it was the most fun that I ever had with the PvE in Dark Souls 3, by far. It was just such an experience. Is there anything that would make you want to return to a PvP game? I know that you played Absolver recently, not for that long, but do you ever like miss that experience as a content creator? Is that something that you would ever want to go back to, or are you really dead set on challenge runs now, and that's the main kind of content that you would want to move forward with?
I don't think that the direction of my channel would ever go heavily into multiplayer stuff as the main focus. I think I'd always have a stronger focus on something that just is individualized, whether it's like a speedrun on a game. It doesn't even have to be Souls. It could just be a speedrun on a game, casual playthroughs of things like the first time I go through them, challenges, whatever. But then there definitely can be things from time to time that are multiplayer where it just works really well. And I think for something to stick where it's like a component, you know, going into the future and has longevity with the channel, would require community support and dev support beyond what we've seen on a lot of stuff lately. Like, for example, Absolver had a really good start, but you kind of know how it went, right? So,
yeah, unfortunately, I do.
Are there any games upcoming that you're interested in?
Actually, yeah, like right after we stop this podcast, I'm playing Evil Within 2. So that's like, the thing is, I don't get super hype about things to be kind of safe on the safe side, where I don't let myself down if something's not that great. But I almost have a feeling like it's 100% certain that it's going to be good and even better than the first. And the first one was such a good game that I actually can't wait. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Actually, I never played the first Evil Within, but I was watching some streams playing the second one a bit earlier, and I watched your playthrough of the first one, and the second one looks pretty crazy from what I've seen.
Yeah, I haven't really seen much at all other than just the trailer.
Is it like a direct sequel to the first one?
Yep. Yeah, I believe it is. And there's a lot of story elements, and there's a lot of loose ends that aren't like kind of tied up from the first, so it will probably address that kind of stuff.
Are there any games that you enjoy but don't stream or think that people wouldn't watch, and why?
There's things that I've played like a long time ago, like when I was younger, that I would honestly like to stream at some point. But I don't know if people... I mean, I think actually people wouldn't mind watching them, but I also don't know if it would take a larger priority over what I'd already do anyways. Like, I might not enjoy it as much as what I've planned to do into the future, but like things like I mentioned Banjo-Kazooie. Like, I really liked Banjo-Kazooie. I would love to play that again on stream. Like Metroid Fusion, really liked that. That was one of my favorite games. I'd love to play that on stream. Mega Man X. I never got to play the Super Nintendo version, but I played the handheld version, and I would love to play like the full one. So stuff like that would be pretty cool, like older stuff. But there's nothing else that I play off stream or like that I am interested in right now. So,
are there any games that you would like to no hit in the future? Like we were talking before the podcast, like Breath of the Wild or something. Games like that? Yeah, like variety.
Not at the moment, just because I feel like it would have to be something that I would like to, you know, put time into. And like everything that I've wanted to know his so far, like, has just been based around Souls, because it's just, they're really good games, right? They're, and it actually kind of works for that too. It works for the type of games they are. But maybe there might be something that comes up that would be cool. Actually, there's one thing I can mention. This is kind of like a random shout out, but Hermit was doing Ocarina of Time no hit runs, and I don't know anything about that game. I've never completed it, but it looks really cool. So It does show that you can do them on other things, and I think that is one of the really interesting things about it, because like I don't know much about that, and it's just exciting because like the whole no-hit thing as well. So I'm not even drawn to it because I'm a fan of Zelda. I'm not a huge fan of Zelda at all, but it makes it cool. So I'm sure there's other things that exist, new and old, that could have like no-hit runs and stuff.
What about
no-hit Banjo-Kazooie?
No, I don't know about that, man. That would be kind of ridiculous, in my opinion.
Maybe. But what about speed runs and stuff like you were saying, like Ocarina of Time and stuff like that? Have you ever considered that?
Ocarina speed runs, first of all, are really, really hard. So I don't think I would speed run that because I haven't played it before, like fully. But Evil Within 2, if it goes well, I know there's going to be people that speed run it. I know one person right now that has pretty good times on Evil Within 1 that will be doing it. So like I'm sure there's going to be other people. I'm sure there's a leaderboard for the first one. I've just seen one person, particularly that like is really into the first one, and his channel like thrives off of doing speedruns on the older one, and it's not even really that popular of a game. So I know it would be something of interest for people to watch, but I don't know if it's going to be too long of a run. So I have to figure out how many hours it's going to end up being, so it can fit in. But there's going to be other things in the future. Shadow of the Colossus, when it comes out, I'm sure it's going to be really good to speedrun after, because that also has a community around it for speedrunning for like the older releases that are not like the remade one.
I almost forgot that they're remaking that game.
Yeah, that's in January.
It looks awesome.
It's already got a release date?
Yeah.
Did not know that.
Yeah, it's so soon after Last Guardian as well. It's funny that Last Guardian took like 10 years to make, but then the new Shadow of the Colossus is being remastered, and it's almost like in the same year, right?
That's not like an entirely new game.
Yeah, but I mean, it's being made from the ground up, is it not?
I think so.
I don't know too much about it personally.
I know that like Last Guardian was disappointing to me because it didn't have combat, really. So I was like, man, I've never played Shadow of the Colossus, but like this one's new, so like it would be cool if it had combat and all that. And apparently it wasn't that great. I don't know.
It had okay reviews from what I saw. I never got around to it. I loved Ico, or Ico, whatever, however it's pronounced, and I loved Shadow of the Colossus.
Yeah, Ico I heard of, and I wish I had known of both of them when I had a PS2, but I didn't. Oh, by the way, is there supposed to be another question?
I was trying to give everyone else a chance to talk, but I guess I can just jump into some more. We have some random questions listed too. What is your favorite food?
Favorite food is sushi, man. Definitely.
Sushi's good. Oh yeah. Sushi is my favorite too, Skula.
I've had sushi like twice this week. Can't get enough.
Really? Yeah, so I find that, like, as funny as it is, like, it's definitely not the most popular food ever, but, like, so many people I know like it, so that's one thing that's cool. Like, anytime there's been, like, when I've met some other casters and shit, and, like, we've hung out, we've eaten some, like, really good food, and most of the time it's sushi, so that's pretty funny.
I feel like the two most popular answers to that question that I've heard are either sushi or pizza.
Yeah, that's true. That's actually very true.
Do you have any plans of going to TwitchCon next year, Skula?
Next year, I don't know, but like, I don't want to say yes for sure, and I don't want to say no for sure, because I don't even know. Like, I might, but I feel like I might just feel the same as I did this time around, where I don't want to make the decision because other people want me to, and I really do have no interest in like anything that goes on inside the actual convention center itself. So again, it would be one of those things where I have no problem doing something like cool, where you know, maybe everybody plans some sort of like meeting up kind of thing, but I can understand that the people that are going, they probably like the entire experience. They probably want to be there for, you know, getting to check out some of the booths there, trying to, like, you know, meet their favorite streamers, trying to you know, see some new things that they're, like, you know, showing off, and then maybe like the music guests they like or whatever. But I just don't feel like I have much business in the convention center itself.
Need your own edgy booth.
Or, like, I could just make another center beside it that's completely different.
I can appreciate that for sure. I remember a few months ago, you had a community meetup at the Twitch Toronto community meetup. How did that go, and what was that like for you? Was that the first time that you had met people from your community in person before, or...?
It wasn't the first time I had met people that, like, it wasn't a lot of people from my community, because it was kind of a thing that's, it was an event that's like a local sort of TwitchCon based thing. So they do these, local events that someone will organize, but it's like endorsed through the site and like promoted on like the Twitter and all that stuff, so that it can give people a chance to do like meetups that are closer to them rather than do ones that are specifically in one place all the time. So they have them in other places too. I heard there was like one in like Chicago, there was like one in, I don't know, like some other place in Canada, and then there's one over in Toronto as well. And the one in Toronto was good. Definitely, it was really cool. I'm going to the next one for sure. It was fun, and there was a handful of people that were there that had subbed to me in the past or like just followed, and you know, that I knew for a while. I think it was really cool to meet. I think Darkhearted Kill was one of the coolest people to meet, because like, yeah, like some of the other people I actually had seen their stream. So like, even though they had like watched me or like subbed to me or whatever, like I watched their stream, but Darkhearted Kill, I don't think anyone like knew about, in terms of like, cause he doesn't stream or anything. He's just like part of a lot of communities. So it was really cool to meet him. Already knew a lot of people, like just by looking at them, cause again, they're casters. And then like, so the people that I went with, I had known for a while. So yeah, it was cool. It was just basic. It was almost like everyone already knew each other for like a lot of it, except for maybe like little things here and there. But there was some new people that were really nice. And ironically, even though it wasn't like the interactions that I had that were good, they weren't like business oriented, but then those people actually ended up becoming members of the stream and like actually, you know, coming back in the future, and like they still will watch the stream at this point, and I'll still watch theirs. But it's not like a weird sort of thing, because I hate the whole like, hey, like first things first, business cards, like why should I watch you, this and that. Like, I don't want to like sell, and I don't want to be sold stuff. That's why I don't like the idea of TwitchCon that much. I know that goes on, that definitely is part of it. It's not like the biggest emphasis to, you know, do that, but I know it's a thing, and I've been told that happens.
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, there's that like aspect of it where it's a network or networking opportunity for a lot of people. For me personally, going to TwitchCon would more be a chance to meet people who I had only talked to online before and like hang out with them in real life. That I would probably only meet a handful of people if I went this year who I knew, but I think that would be a really cool thing to have for a few days.
Yeah, also because it's a massive amount of people. That's the thing about it that, like, it kind of sucks, because it is a lot of people, and it would get every... It would basically, like, be convenient because of how many people would be all in the same spot from, like, so far around the world as well. Like, not even just North America, but also, like, EU and, like, UK and stuff like that. Even maybe some people from Australia, but, like, that kind of thing, too. There's people that are actually, like, making big trips there. And that wouldn't be possible, like on short notice, or like, you know, as a side plan for a lot of people, wouldn't be an option, rather than like giving them a reason to be there. So it works out in that way, where it's a lot of people. Yo, McDrunkard, Darth Swam was sweet talking you earlier. He was saying very nice things about you.
I think Swam's Discord crashed.
Oh no.
Hence the silence on his end.
I'll pretend to be him and ask myself questions then.
Alright, we'll send you our question list so you can be ready.
Alright, cool.
But I did want to ask, because I know you've done challenge runs on Dark Souls 1, 2, and 3, and on Bloodborne. I don't know about Demon Souls necessarily. If you have, I haven't caught those. But which one has been the most challenging for you personally?
You know what? I feel like Bloodborne had this learning curve to it that I didn't get over because the hours I put into it. I just hadn't really played it as much as the other, like, than DS 1, 2, and 3. Like, I just hadn't put as many hours into it. And there was, like, this initial, like, hump where... when I was doing runs on that, like, and it wasn't necessarily no hit runs, it was before that. It was like when I started doing actual challenges on it after doing casual playthroughs and all the PvP that I did on it. It was really hard, because I usually play Bloodborne for a little bit, then I put it down for a while. Like, I would put it down for like half a year or something like that, and then come back to it. So I don't actually have like a huge amount of time in comparison to the other times. Maybe now it's a bit more. So that definitely was the biggest challenge, because I didn't even get over the learning curve of doing challenge runs on it until I started really like putting more time into it and stuff.
And then was that just the no hit on there, or weren't you doing like blood level 4 speed runs for a minute too?
Yeah, I was doing blood level 4 speed runs. I still am going to try to see if I can get one that's under 2 hours in in-game time. And yeah, the no hit stuff was hard too, but I don't think it was around that time. I think this was like going back to like when I did Deathless originally, and then just regular blood level 4. Like regular blood level 4 was really hard. Like it was so hard that I actually got kind of mad. Like at the end, it was salty. It was really, really difficult.
I still haven't finished the DLC on my blood level 4. It's, yeah, like Ludwig is just a motherfucker. he's so hard at level 4.
I can agree with that, definitely. You gotta be very, very determined, very patient, and like you have to understand like the fights take a long time.
Yeah, yeah, I haven't like gotten
when you successfully get them
to starting my blood level 4 yet. I just remember I was stuck on Soul of Cinder for so long on my soul level 1. It was terrible. Like, I remember when I started out my soul level 1, I was like, oh yeah, this is fun. Like, it's a nice challenge. It's something different. By the end of it, it was like, oh my god. I don't even know how many times I tried fighting Soul of Cinder, just like praying for the right RNG.
Dude, Soul of Cinder is literally like, it is the embodiment of evil in life. It is just like, dude, I have so many bad things. If I ever like unleashed every bad word I could say, it would just be about Soul Ascender.
What do you think about his kick attack?
Okay, the kick thing used to be kind of annoying, but then like I feel the kick you can get over pretty easily. The kick is definitely not the hardest thing, but I think the problem people have with it is they're not actually getting kicked by his foot. They're just standing too close to his hitbox, and it like does damage before the kick fully extends, so you can get hit early on it, like by his kneecap and shit. So I think it's stuff like that that is the biggest problem.
Random question. I mean, well, not exactly random, but what has been your favorite challenge run to do in terms of your like either personal enjoyment or satisfaction out of having completed it?
Mental health.
I can give two answers. So basically for personal enjoyment, where it doesn't have to be the most satisfying thing ever, but it's the most enjoyable throughout. Item randomizer was definitely the most fun throughout. Like the entirety of it was an equal good vibe the entire time. And really, really funny too. And then the most satisfying ever was probably the Bloodborne All Boss Plus DLC.
I had a feeling that's what you were going to say.
Yeah, that was super satisfying because that's my favorite game. So I just, it was cool. Like I could never, it could disappear. It could just disappear from existence and I'd be happy still. I wouldn't have to play it again. It'd be fine.
Yeah, Bloodborne has a really special place in my heart in terms of the PvE content. It just, there's really just something special about it in comparison to the other Souls games, which are really excellent games in their own right, but Bloodborne just has that X factor to it that really makes it special.
Yeah, exactly. That's true. Leron with the no roll SL1 Manus.
Dude, when are we gonna see it?
I have the highlight of it, dude. That's actually how the meme emote was made, because my face after I was actually about to go insane and someone screenshotted it.
On the topic of most enjoyable and favorite runs, what was your least enjoyable and least favorite challenge run to complete?
No, SL1 no rule was the least fun on DS3, and I didn't complete it. That's why it wasn't, I stopped because it wasn't fun after a while. It was just painful on Cinder, and I could have done it. I know I could have just put more time into it and got it, but it just wasn't really satisfying. I felt like if I did it, I wouldn't feel any different. I would just probably feel worse.
What about your, did you ever finish, I don't think you did, but your fight stick run?
Oh yeah, I finished that. That was Did you? That was really good. I like that a lot, yeah. I'm probably gonna do it again with the DLC 2 as well.
Are there any runs that you would like to do but can't for one reason or another, or any other games that you would like to do runs in?
Okay, so on the topic of ones that I want to do but can't, like literally can't, Fight Stick on DS1 I can't do. I want to try to use my Fight Stick on DS1, but I think the one that I have just won't work with it. And there's a bunch of complications that go into it, but it's just not cooperating. And then I guess things that I'd like to be good at, but I just don't like have a lot of experience with, would probably just be related to, like, I don't know. Like, I think there's some cool like platforming games that'd be really cool to speedrun, to be good at. Like Mega Man X, I would love to be good at speedrunning, but I never played it that much. And then,
have you played Cuphead yet, or not quite?
No, I'm going to after we finish the DSU run. I think it's a possibility. It's definitely a good possibility.
Because I've been seeing like Faraz and Distortion doing speedruns of that.
Yeah, they look like really, really hard runs too, but like fun though.
Yeah, like, no, exactly.
Is that a game that you would be interested in doing runs of if you enjoy it enough?
I don't think so. But I think I would play it more than once. I think I would do the first playthrough, and then I would do like the expert mode, at least at the very, very minimum. Maybe I would try speedruns for a little bit just to get like a time that I'm happy with. But I don't think I'd go for like a world record on it or anything like that.
I think Distortion has world record right now at like 27 minutes or something.
It's yeah. I think it's 26 minutes 50 seconds the last time I checked, which Dist has.
Yeah, but that's
yeah, that is that. I mean, that's all bosses in the game, so that's a ridiculous time. That's really fast.
I think it will get more interesting if when the devs nerf or like get rid of the weapon swap.
Yeah, they'll probably have different categories where there's like the old patch with some of the skips that they're using, like the boss freezes and the monkey skip and weapon swap glitch. I think they're probably going to nerf that, or at least like fix the bugs, so there will be, you know, current patch speedruns, and I'm not sure what they'll use. They'll probably use charge shot.
I haven't even seen any of the skips. I don't even know what they look like.
There are a few where they basically freeze the bosses in place and like break their AI so they can just keep hitting them.
Wow, kind of like the insane Abyss Watcher skip.
Yeah, exactly. It saves a lot of time, but yeah, it's pretty broken.
I definitely need to check that out then. I have not seen that yet. That's funny.
Are there any other challenge runs that you have planned right now that the community may not know about, or are those things that you want to continue to keep under wraps?
There's one that I kind of wanted to keep a secret, but I tested it and I tried. I even got help from one of the mods. You guys probably know Colpster, right? He tried to help me with something that was related to it. And like, I ended up explaining it and explaining the surprise because I don't think I could get it to work. I wanted to do two simultaneous playthroughs with one like set of inputs, so like one controller. But the thing was that it would be like double the RNG because like everything going on one game would be different than the other. So it was not possible to do it on two different platforms because there's a desync between them with console movement and stuff like that due to the frame rate, and then due to like just like the overall just the input delay and stuff like that, making it shift in time slowly. So you couldn't have it synced properly. And then you can't open two instances of it on PC with the program that Colpster was talking to me about. So if I can find out how to do two instances of it somehow on one system, then I definitely want to do that. That would be the coolest run, I think, that I've thought of trying with DS3.
A way you could try to get around doing that too is you could get two separate systems and play with separate controllers. Like, I remember one of my first experiences on Twitch was because I found a YouTube video of this guy who did a speedrun with three separate N64s.
Oh, okay.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
I know of the dude, the speedrun. I think it was three Super Nintendos or something. Might be the same guy.
Yeah, he had three N64s, and he played GoldenEye, Super Mario 64, and Legend of Zelda Ocarina of Time. Like, all three at the same time.
What was he using, like his feet and his other hand or something?
Well, he would be, like, when he was going through text on Legend of Zelda, he would be, like, moving on GoldenEye and, like, crazy shit like that.
That is nuts. Wow. Okay, that's a really good idea, actually. That's insane. But, yeah, I guess you could do that. That's actually a really good point. So, there'd be a goal of, like, maybe, like, a time limit and then, like, I can't die on both or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think the idea of like syncing it properly would be sick because like there you'll have situations where imagine you just get to Pontiff and like he just doesn't do the same swing on the one game, but you're in the same spot, you're doing the same actions, but like you have to find out a way to not die on the other one and somehow make it through, and you're gonna have to take hits from certain stuff, but you have to like find out a way to like outweigh the pros and cons of both and like somehow come out on top by thinking through all of the stuff that is just not the same on either, you know, that it just... It seemed like a really cool idea. And when I tried it, I actually did a test on Gundyr where I killed Gundyr with the setup like that, with it being desynced and all that. So I know if it's synced, you can do it. It would just be really cool and kind of weird at the same time.
Yeah.
But yeah.
But Miyazaki has to go ruin everything with his RNG.
Oh, man.
One question I had for you is, now that FromSoft have basically said that the Souls series is done, at least as we know it as Dark Souls, there might be more Soulsborne games coming out in the future, but that hasn't really been confirmed yet. But what are your plans for the future once you kind of run out of runs that you can do with Dark Souls games? Are there any other series that you've looked at playing, or are you kind of just keeping your eye out on the horizon? I know that's something that a lot of the Dark Souls 3 PvP streamer community, like myself and Joey, both have struggled with, where we're kind of in limbo with not really having any primary game or IP that we can focus on. And I don't know if you and Faraz and some of the other challenge runners and no hitters are just kind of like waiting and seeing how it goes, or if you're kind of figuring out what you want to be doing next. But that's something that I know a lot of Souls content creators have been having issues with. So I was wondering what your take on that was.
I think the way it'll go is basically just like kind of playing stuff as it comes along that I like, because I definitely will not do things I don't like. I'm not going to just play something because, even if it was popular, I'm not going to just play something because of that. I want to play something that I like. So there are things next year that I'm definitely going to be playing that I would imagine I'm probably going to like. I don't know how much longevity they'll have, because I remember we had that discussion before when we were testing the audio stuff, like that longevity of something's not guaranteed, right? So things next year that I know are for certain going to be, like, I'm gonna do a playthrough at least once of them, is gonna be Shadow of the Colossus. There's gonna be what's it called, Code Vein.
Oh, Code Vein. Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, Code Vein. What else is coming out next year that is gonna be pretty cool? There was something that kind of reminded me, it was made by the people that did Crysis. It's made by Crytek, and it's like this hunting game, like where you hunt, like it's like a two-person on two-person thing where you can like, you use like a lot of these different skills to like hunt down people in like a map, and that looked pretty cool, and I was thinking maybe I would actually look into that. There's another game that doesn't have a release date that is apparently Souls-like that I saw a trailer of, that you know like, it kind of, there's just all these like little things. Blasphemous might be next year. I don't know if it's late this year or next year. That's a guaranteed first. I'm gonna play it at least once.
Yeah, Blasphemous looks really cool.
Yeah, so like I have some things written down that are of interest at the end of this year and stuff like that. Like Swam was talking about Odyssey, and I was saying I might just give it a first time playthrough and check it out. But there's at least some first playthroughs of things, and then when it comes to like longevity and all that, Some of them will probably have a decent amount, and some of them will probably be something that I like to speedrun. I can see Shadow of the Colossus and Blasphemous definitely being good for speedruns. Code Vein maybe, but I'm not sure. And then when it comes to FromSoft's next like lineup of stuff, it has been stated by them, like they've confirmed and like solidified the whole statement of something that Souls fans will like, something that is for Armored Core people, and something that apparently is like VR based. So I have a pretty decent feeling they're going to make something that's good. And I also have this weird feeling that it's possibly going to be like the best they've done so far. Like they're going to just do something really sick. So I'm actually looking forward to the whole, like, you know, moving on from the stuff we've been doing now more than kind of how you're saying people are feeling. I'm actually like pretty excited for it personally.
No, I am too. Cause like, Darva was mentioning in the last podcast, like when Bloodborne got announced, that shit was hype. Everyone was stoked off of that trailer. It looked amazing.
Yeah, yeah,
and
exactly.
I just can't wait because Dark Souls 3 was supposed to be the last one. We'll see if they stick to that. I have a feeling they will. They did a pretty good job kind of wrapping things up with that last DLC. But just even if it's not Bloodborne 2, just another new Souls-like FromSoft I would lose my fucking shit over.
Oh yeah, definitely. And the thing is what you said with Bloodborne as well. For a first playthrough of anything that I've done, it was an experience that was so awesome that I don't think it would be impressive if something could outdo that. And I'm not even exaggerating a bit. Like, it was so, I was so genuinely hyped that I invested so much like of myself into the idea before I had even actually played it. And I usually don't do that. And that's why I stopped doing it after that, because I'm like, you know what? Wasn't so good that I got that hyped about it, because I could have been really, really sad after if it wasn't good. So it was that one thing in recent time that I can even remember where I was just so overly excited before even really knowing too much. And it delivered even more than I thought it would. So I got like the best out of it, but it could have been pretty bad if it didn't deliver.
Yeah.
And it was so good though. It was the best thing ever, honestly. Like,
nothing has reminded me more of my first time playing Dark Souls 1 than like my first time playing Bloodborne. Even like playing Dark Souls 2 for the first time, it's like I still kind of knew what to expect from a Souls title. I had played the shit out of the first one. I knew what I was getting myself into. But with Bloodborne, all that feeling of familiarity was gone. But there were just like some slight elements that reminded me of previous Souls titles. And even the map design with all the shortcuts was very reminiscent of Dark Souls 1. Like, I just loved that game.
Yeah, I can definitely agree. It had a lot. It did what DS1 did best, but in a completely different setting.
I feel like that's part of why speedruns and challenge runs for Bloodborne are still so, like, relevant even.
Yeah, I mean, well, okay, the thing, that's why I was also, this is another thing okay, for anyone that's watching this right now, we had a lot of good discussion before this podcast even started, like, a while ago. But one of the topics was, again, like, just, like, longevity of, like, Souls games on this platform. And it's, like, it's actually ridiculous how much longevity some of them have gotten. Like, I would say the only thing that's truly dead is Demon's Souls. Because even when, like, I'm not saying it's going to be super, super populated with people that are, like, doing first playthroughs or, you know, casual stuff necessarily. But, like, there's still a fair amount of people doing, you know, world record attempt speedruns on DS1 even, where you'll see the directory go to, like a above mid-tier level even, and it's pretty crazy. It's, like, how old it is. I mean, it shows that it still has longevity. I believe DS1 will still be relevant to a degree even in another couple years, personally. Because it just has that appeal, right? Like, I don't know.
No, definitely.
It's almost kind of like timeless to enjoy, like, and it might just be someone coming back to it. It might be someone doing a speed run after not speedrunning it for a while. It might be for any reason, but I feel like there's no reason anyone wouldn't still want to even see it or play it in the future. And I feel like, you know, when they do something new, my prediction would be that it would definitely be that kind of impact. It would be similar to how we've seen everything else where it has that longevity, because they're so good at longevity. They have this, it's like magic, man. Honestly, it's just.
And do you have any kind of idea as to why Dark Souls has had that longevity with its titles, as especially because I feel like the games that succeed the most on Twitch, especially, like if you look at the directory, the top games are going to be League of Legends, Hearthstone, PUBG, Warframe, all Overwatch, Counter-Strike, Destiny, all games with multiplayer elements. And you could argue Dark Souls has the PvP side of it, but for the most part, you see people doing challenge runs, no-hit runs, those sort of things, and they're still remaining relevant, like we were saying. And most PvE-oriented games like that don't have that kind of longevity. Did everyone die? I think everyone died. All by myself. This is spoopy. I think Miyazaki heard us talking shit about him. Discord is completely sunny side up right now. One way to put it. Squilla, if you can hear me, you can try leaving Discord entirely and then coming back, possibly. Oh, man. Well, at least I'm here. So I'll just go ahead and ask myself questions, I guess. What position do I sleep in? On my side, hugging an anime body pillow. And favorite food? Anything weeb-tastic? Who was my worst coworker? I worked with this 16-year-old girl I worked at a cupcake shop for a while, and this girl was just so dumb. She's the worst, easily the worst coworker I've had. Actually, I take that back. I had a supervisor at that same job who he would walk into the coat closet and huff nasal spray, and he was just so dumb and messed everything up. Easily the worst coworker I've ever had. Are you guys having issues with Discord as well? Is it not just us?
servers are down on Discord. Well, I guess someone was mentioning the Twitch desktop app. Guess we could try that. I'll see how this works. I sent invites. This is fine.
Totally fine. I meant for this to happen. This is all, it's part of the shtick.
It's all part of the thing. Yeah, entirely intentional.
I sent Sloth and Squilla an invite for the voice call through the Twitch desktop app. I don't know if they're paying attention right now. But what a convenient time for Discord to go down, right? Conveniency is key. Oh, an edgy challenger has arrived. I can't hear him for some reason. I see it lighting up like he's talking. But I don't hear it.
Yeah, I'm talking. I'm in his thing right now. Wait, I got to use.
There you are. I can hear you now.
There I am. Does it sound better than Discord?
Yeah, it does, actually. You sound way better.
Sweet. Okay.
I'd turn you down. Hold up.
Okay, Swam wants you to send him the invite.
All right, cool. Got Sloth in here.
This looks way better than Discord.
Yeah, this isn't bad. Not bad.
This is pretty sick. What is this? What is this supposed to be?
This is do you have the Twitch desktop app?
No, I don't. I don't even know how I access this. Like, I guess I just click. I don't know what's going on. I'm scared.
Twitch released a desktop app that's pretty shit. I downloaded it when they came out with it, but I didn't even know you could do this with it.
Yeah, it's weird.
Sloth, I see your thing lighting up, but I don't hear you.
Damn,
that's nice. I can see all our little avatars. We're looking real cute.
Okay. He said he got a network error.
Well, shit.
I'm kind of like I'm mediating both situations right now.
I know. Very convenient time for this to happen.
Is there a way you can make a link that's different?
I don't even know how I made
that.
The
could
first
be the name
link
of the channel for the next time, or just the title, Sick Podcast XD. Yeah.
Sick Podcast.exe.
Yeah. Oh boy.
I'm calling King Swam.
Okay, now apparently he's trying to call you.
Hello? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you, Sloth.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, well, while we're waiting on Swam, we can just jump right back into it. So, Squilla.
Yeah.
How does one increase the dankness of a meme?
Okay, wait, this is kind of weird because he's... Okay, Swam, we're continuing the thing because they're asking questions now, so I'm going to mute this. I'm going to mute myself on here, but put a message in
oh
here.
Oh, my God, what have I done?
Yeah. So keep trying to join the inviter, accept the call. I'm just going to mute myself.
There we go. Oh, my God. I opened up Discord and I had the word echo.
the portal to the Matrix, man. I just heard that, too. And I had the audio from the stream playing at the same time. It was like Quadra Echo or something. I don't know.
Squilla multiplied.
Yeah. Okay, what was the question? Sorry.
How does one increase the dankness of a meme?
If you want to have a well-aged meme that holds up over time and just kind of like has that memingness to it, you have to have the meme not be overused when it releases. You have to know about the meme, maybe even pre-release, but you don't want to leak it and you don't want to overdo it too early. You want to kind of ease into it and ramp it up over a year span towards the end of the year from the release. You want to kind of just start using it more and more and more and more and more. And you want to find an event. You want to find some place in time where it can explode. Like, you want to be explosive with it when you're ready to go all in with that meme. So yeah, I can hear you. I can see your picture too. You look like it's like a buff Shaggy. What is that? It's like a buff Jay Shaggy. All right.
I can't hear Swam.
I can't hear Swam either. I can see it lighting up like he's trying to talk.
I can hear him. Maybe okay, Swam. Adjust your audio settings in the call right now. That's what I had to do to be heard. So it could be.
Also, thank you everyone who waited for us to get that figured out. That was completely out of our control, but I appreciate you sticking around to hear the remainder of the podcast. So thanks everyone.
And I wanted to ask too, I'm gonna pull up footage right now.
Oh no, is this what's happening?
Of your very first meme.
My first meme. Oh no.
I want a little explanation for people in chat.
Oh my god.
Go ahead and let it play real quick.
Make sure the audio's on.
I've got the audio on.
My cat. Right.
We'll try not to talk over this too much.
It's a tabby. And I can't find it. And that's not good. And it's really dark out. It's pretty scary. All right. Some bushes. Chance, where are you? Chance.
Holy fuck, it's a goblin!
Alright. We get a little context on that for the people listening.
Okay, so again, the whole story I told you guys a little bit earlier, but me and my buddy, we were like, we just pulled an all-nighter. We wanted to make videos because he had like a camcorder kind of thing. And we were thinking of ideas. So that was one of them. And that actually ended up turning into a video that triggered so many people. And it actually got like quite a bit of views for the time, like of when we uploaded on YouTube. We weren't YouTubers. This is the first time we ever uploaded a video in general. Like that's what we were trying to do. We were trying to plan like our first actual video. Well, I guess okay, technically we did do some stuff with skating that we would upload here and there. Some of it was private, but like first actual video where we're like trying to like find an idea that's original or like new or something, or just like triggering or clickbait, whatever. And we didn't even really know what it was going to be. And then we just thought of, yo, like, just how about like, my buddy's like, why don't you just run at the camera and pretend you're like a monster or something like that. And I'm like, okay, we'll call it Goblin Sighting. And we just went like into like an area that was dark, and originally I was supposed to pop out of a bush, but you couldn't see that because you didn't have lighting or anything. So it was it was just out of, like, you know, nothing, like, in the moment, and it ended up making people so mad. If you look at the comments, we already went over that too, right? So pretty bad comments.
Is the audio good now? Pretty fantastic.
Yeah, now it's, I can hear the audio.
Can Sloth and Joey?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay, fucking perfect. All right, thank you. Sorry if I cut you off.
You're good.
Oh man, we got the comment section on the stream.
Just briefly, just let the people get a glimpse.
So, how does it feel to be a goblin?
Being a goblin is, like, probably a lot harder than being a goblin for, like, 10 seconds. So, I don't actually really know. I wish I did. But, like, originally we were going to, like, even get a mask from, like, a Halloween store. Like, we were thinking maybe we should just wait and get, like, a mask or something, or find one that he might have somewhere laying around. And then I'm like, we're just like, nah, let's just, like, go, like, let's try to be so trolly that we don't do anything special at all, and, like, just see if people will think it's real. And there was, you saw yourself, there was people that actually got mad. They were like, hey, I was, like, really excited that this was real, but it wasn't, and stuff like that.
Yeah, someone just posted the best comment from that video, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the best comment right there, pretty much.
Nothing like a good old YouTube comment section.
Yeah, the YouTube comment section is what is my life force.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I think it's even better than, like, Reddit or 4chan. All you need is the YouTube comment section.
Oh, dude, it's terrible.
It's definitely the dark side of humanity, for sure.
Yeah.
But, well, so, Skula, was Dark Souls 2 PvP the first thing you ever streamed?
Yeah, like, literally the first thing. Like, the day I streamed the first time, it was, I think it was for, like, half an hour. And it wasn't even, like, me being able to play. It was just, like, I don't even think I played. I think I just had the game running, and I was just trying to get OBS to not drop frames and not crash. I'm pretty sure I crashed, like, OBS crashed, I think, more than, like, 5 times. And it was just troubleshooting. Like, it wasn't even really a stream. It was just like that was the case for a while, like weeks into the first month. And then even after that, I would still crash at least once per stream, and I would have dropped frames every, like, minute or so, or like every, like, few minutes. It was lucky if you could actually get, like, a stable picture, because I had, like, minimal knowledge on how that worked, and my ISP was really bad at the time too, and my computer was really bad too, so it was terrible. I almost gave up, actually.
I remember, too, we've had a discussion, like, this was probably like a year ago when we were talking about this. Kind of had a similar start streaming, both of us, with the fact that, see, when I first started streaming, I didn't use a mic. And I was just completely silent. And I just had this, like, idea in my head. Because, like, I watched so many playthroughs on YouTube of games, and I was like, man, I just really wish there wasn't this person talking over this. I wish I could just watch the gameplay in silence. And so I was like, no one does that. I'm going to be that person. And I did that for, like, probably like the first month of streaming. And it's like, I'd have my mic on. And so you'd hear me, like, cough or something every now and then. But, like, I just didn't talk. And it wasn't until one day someone came into my stream and they were like, hey, bro, why don't you talk? And I just, like, thought about it for a minute, and I was like, every other streamer I've ever seen talks, like, why don't I talk?
Yeah, that's I think, actually, when you're talking about, I think one of the questions earlier, this might have been what Sloth was asking after the longevity thing, like, what would you say for aspiring, like, edge people or edge lords? I was assuming that was directed towards people that are, like, trying to make content or whatever, but one thing that's, like, super, super important is commentary. Like, you have to commentate. I don't think you can't grow a channel if you're silent. Like, and it's not really I'm not trying to be offensive to someone that can't speak. I actually know people that are, they've gotten some success for themselves, for having, like, issues with speaking, whether it's, like, a personal thing, whether it's actually, like, a medical thing, whether it's, like, you know, something or other. Like, I know people that have had channels that actually did decently well considering the situation. But like for the most part, you do, if you're able to, like you do want to commentate, you do want to have commentary. You don't need anything else other than commentary and gameplay. That's the, those are the two things that are necessary.
Yeah, personally, I hate overlays, and I know people like Tolo and them, like they really dislike overlays, but I like really, really dislike overlays for some reason. I want to watch the gameplay and listen to the streamer, and that's about it, and maybe music, and that's basically how I run my stuff. So but
I can agree
on the like speaking, I think as long as you have like music, I think you're pretty good to go, because I know this one partner that is totally deaf, so he doesn't really speak, so he but he has a partner channel, but he does like specifically Nintendo stuff, and it used to be kind of easy to do Nintendo stuff, but now it's like really, really difficult.
Yeah, they have some rules about like not streaming their games, and content creators and Nintendo don't get along, to make it a short story, I guess.
Oh yeah,
well,
big
that's
time.
That's YouTube. Twitch is fully free to go, but now it's just like it's become a little oversaturated.
Oh, and I know there were some issues with Atlas. They didn't want people streaming Persona 5 past a certain in-game date.
Okay.
Yeah, that's stupid.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure Nintendo doesn't want their stuff on Twitch, but they have no real like power to take it off Twitch. Because I will be damned if like they start taking off Mario 64 speedruns or Ocarina of Time speedruns.
Yeah, that'd be ridiculous. That would actually be a huge, huge hit to take for the platform in terms of like traffic, because some of the biggest sources of traffic have been Ocarina and SM64 in general, like out of anything, not even just like, okay, if we just set aside esports, we're talking about games that aren't competitive.
Yeah, like
nothing.
Clint Stevens.
Yeah, Clint Stevens and like, you know, even some select others, but mainly even just like the stuff he's done. Like that's one of the biggest sources of traffic for those things. And even more so than so many directories. So like, you definitely don't want to take those away. That'd be a significant impact in its popularity and all that.
I feel like that would just be like a big cut to Nintendo, though. It wouldn't really be like, it obviously would be a cut to other people, but not as bad as to Nintendo, because that's free advertising.
Yeah, exactly.
But at the same time, I feel like that is something that they would do in the future.
Like, even the thing is, with them speedrunning and stuff like that, like, people are still buying actual Nintendos and physical hardware, physical cartridges. They're still, and I mean, they're probably not really making revenue off that, because all the cartridges they've had are, like, floating around. They're not producing more, so they're not really making anything. But it's putting it out there still, and, like, I mean, they should appreciate that. If I was them, I'd be like, hey, it's really cool that people still want to do this, even if it's, like, in this way. They're still trying to find the hardware. They're still trying to, like, they're making content in this time where it's so easy to make content with other stuff that's new, rather than like struggle and, you know, have a setup that's a little bit less convenient to do something older. That's pretty cool in my opinion.
Yeah, agreed.
I wanted to ask you too, Skula, kind of straying away from Dark Souls and the gaming topic in general, about, I know you do guitar covers on YouTube and you listen to a lot of like metal music. What really kind of brought you
into
that?
Die getting back. Like music, like playing music in general?
Yeah, just like the kind of music you listen to and playing music.
Well, okay, like the whole deal with that was basically just like, I'm sure anyone can relate to like what they would listen to in terms of, I guess for me, if it's something that has instruments, like if it's not something that's like produced strictly like in a digital workstation or something like that, if it's not like electronic, if it's not rap, if it's not stuff like that, and it's stuff with instruments, you have your like favorite artists like when you grow up as a kid, right? So it was kind of just a progression of that, just liking different things that link to different things that link to different things. I would say I like a lot of music, though. I like a lot of different stuff, and actually some other genres that have no correlation to stuff with instruments are pretty influential as well. They play a pretty big part of in like you know, stuff that like I would like look for and like think is really cool and stuff. But yeah, that's just, I don't know. I'd say a big inspiration for music I listened to when I was younger was probably my uncle. Like, he has really good taste in music, and he played a little bit of music for a while. He played guitar when he was younger, and then up until probably maybe like 10 years ago, and then he quit. But yeah, he had listened to a lot of music that I also agreed with, and I was like, yeah, this is really cool. So he's probably responsible for a lot of the stuff that kind of evolved into other things.
Yeah, I had kind of a similar experience with them. I listened to a lot of like metal music in high school, and I had an uncle who's like 8 years older than me, and he was in some like local metal band, and he introduced me to like a lot of bands that I listened to that I felt I may have been like a little too young for, but he introduced me to like Under Oath and Suicide Silence, Black Dahlia Murder, and then later like
I love that you mentioned those, because I listened to Suicide Silence and Black Dahlia Murder, two of the first bands of that particular genre that I got into.
So yeah, I was obsessed with both of those bands for the longest time, and like the Faceless, Carnifex.
Oh, yeah.
But all that shit.
Yeah, I can agree. Like, and I think it's just, it keeps just stemming. Like, and if for anybody, like, if you like music, it doesn't matter what genre it is. You just, unless you're the type of person where you just listen to the most popular thing that's on the radio, or that people just generally, like, huge amounts of people like. If you're someone that looks for something more than that, you just have like these interests that will be connecting you to other stuff that reminds you of something, or maybe it doesn't even remind you of something, but maybe it you just like it because it's not the same thing, but it has that effort put into it, or it has, like, I like things where someone puts a lot of creativity and effort into something. It doesn't have to be the same sound, it doesn't have to be like the same anything. It could be like really, really different, it could be drastically different, but if it's just really unique, then I think it's cool.
And speaking of kind of like unique metal bands, as a Canadian, how do you feel about Protest the Hero?
Protest the Hero was my favorite band, or not my favorite, but like, I guess at times I would consider them my favorite. They're not my favorite now, and they're not necessarily the best band I've ever heard in my life, but they were very influential in terms of, like, I listened to them a lot. I own every single album they've made except for, I think, the two, maybe it was only one of them. I think it's Volition. Volition's the only one I think I don't own the physical copy of. Actually, the funny thing is that it plays a big part of my life, because my music teacher in high school was friends with them, and he was the orchestrator for the album Fortress, and he actually played drums on the one track. I think it was Bone Marrow. He plays the drums. He's a fill-in drummer for Bone Marrow on Fortress, and he orchestrated the entire album. He was part of the band Varga back in like the 90s. They went platinum, they were on MTV. He's very inspiring because he just had the whole, like, a really, really solid work ethic with music, and just like he said, I don't want to work a shitty job, I want to be famous, I want to play music, I'm just gonna drum until like I die or whatever. And he would literally just play drums forever until he fell asleep on his kit, like every day as a kid when his family had moved over from the Ukraine to here. And like, he just didn't stop until he actually became, you know, like who he wanted to. And then like, he was always so good at teaching lessons to us about music and just about life as well. Like, so he's one of the best people. And they were actually supposed to come to my school to play a show, and because he knew them, right? And they ended up canceling because they were busy. And he said it wasn't for sure in the first place, but it was something that he really wanted to arrange, and like there was a decent chance it could happen. So I got excited and I brought all my albums to school, and it was the day they were supposed to be there, and then they couldn't because they were caught up in something else. And I was really disappointed, but I did like them like to that degree. And yeah, like that's kind of a connection that I had with them as well. And it was really funny too, because I remember at the time when I had my, I think it was when I had Facebook, like I had my school listed, and some random dude messaged me on Facebook that I had never heard of from the United States, like saying, hey, like, I heard you go to this school, like Dan Fila is your music teacher there, right? Like, or he, like, do you know Dan Fila? Like, I know he's affiliated with Protest or whatever. So like, people had like heard about this, like they don't even, like they aren't even from Canada. It was like really, really weird.
That's crazy.
But yeah, like it was, I have a lot of investment when it comes to them. They're really good. They're also Canadian too, and they...
That's what I was gonna say. Like, as a Canadian, have to like them.
Yeah, they are the most talented musicians I've ever seen at a young age become that popular. And even now, like they've just become so good that like you can see them starting off like being better than any artist might be even in their prime, as like, you know, twice the age, and then getting to the point where they're in like their you know, maybe later 20s or whatever, maybe even almost 30 now. I don't know how long it's been. They're probably late 20s now. And like they actually did become so much better, but you didn't think they could be. Like I couldn't imagine that they would be that good. So
yeah,
they're super talented. It's ridiculous.
Keeping on the topic of Canadian musicians, how do you feel about Rush?
Rush, I've listened to since I was a kid, since I was little. So yeah, Rush is like just good, regardless of. Rush is timeless. There's you can't put a time frame on it. Also, I was born where Neil Peart was born, so I remember like going like downtown. There was the like you'd see his face on flags next to like Dallas Green, and like there was
some that's amazing
influential. Like in the downtown area, like they would have like tributes to artists that were like from the area or whatever, and like there was literally flags like with his face, Dallas Green's face, like other people. It's pretty cool.
I was born right near where Michael Jordan was born, so.
So,
guess what I'm saying is I'm better than you, Squilla.
Oh, so you're shooting hoops with the boys, and Michael J just shows up. He's like, yo, like,
yeah,
check my sick move. And then you just dunk on them, and they're like, yo, like, you got to hang with us. Yeah. Swam, you're cool, bro. Like,
exactly. They call me Swam at IRL. Yeah. Yeah, people,
okay, whatever
people call me by my Twitch username, IRL, because I'm that famous.
Yep.
I'm more famous than Michael Jordan or Shaquille O'Neal combined. So
I had a feeling like you have that way about you that scares me. So
well, I am Shaggy from Scooby-Doo. Like I'm actually Shaggy.
So. You think Shaggy from Scooby-Doo is more famous than Michael Jordan?
Yeah.
I don't know. That's a good question. Probably not. Michael Shaggy Jordan's like one of them.
We need to take a poll. Does anyone in here not know who Shaggy is or not know who Michael Jordan is?
I'm assuming no, like barely anybody in here would not know who Michael Jordan is. Shaggy probably not if they didn't watch Scooby-Doo as a kid. But Michael Jordan, you could hear it from so many more different ways, right? Than just
well, I mean,
one thing.
You can not watch basketball and you would know Michael Jordan. You can not watch Scooby-Doo and you'd know who Shaggy is.
Dude, I watch Space Jam, okay? I know who Michael Jordan is. Space
Scooby-Doo
Jam is
had
my favorite movie.
Scooby-Doo had the movies, they had the shows, they had the snacks, the kids'
yeah,
snacks,
but
and nothing
been
beyond that
since before Michael Jordan. So,
but Michael Jordan is like one of the best basketball players in basketball history. Played on different, you know, teams. I'm pretty sure over time.
Well, there's a Scooby-Doo game. So
he has one of the most popular shoes in basketball shoes or just shoes in general. He was in Space Jam. Like you can't. I don't think
he had a very short-lived golfing career.
Okay, what sold more, the Scooby-Doo movie or Space Jam? We got to look up the box office values.
You're probably
on that.
Right, because the Scooby-Doo movies are shit.
So you think like, your own movie?
Yeah, no.
Scooby-Doo earned
$275 million.
Okay, we're looking up net worth right now. Let's see this. All right, Michael Jordan versus
Space Jam got $230 million
yeah,
USD. So
no,
Scooby-Doo
let's,
earned.
Let's look up the net worth of Shaggy, a cartoon character. Yeah.
Oh no, I'm Matthew. No, I'm talking about the actual dude, not the icon. The dude from the movie.
Oh yeah, of course he's not going to be as famous as Michael
I don't even
Jordan.
Know that
you're,
guy.
You're talking about the actual icon of Shaggy, like Shaggy the character.
Yeah, okay, no, so. Shaggy the character.
Okay, well, I guess we can't really like even gauge success then if we're talking about a cartoon. But okay, I see.
What did you think? I was thinking about the movie specifically.
I thought you meant you were like comparing the dude that played him in the movie to Michael Jordan.
Oh fuck no.
As his character, but like okay, that's yeah. I see.
It's like
yeah,
comparing Michael Jordan to like Bugs Bunny, who was also in Space Jam.
Well, for one,
that's
for
a pretty
one,
stacked
Jordan
roster.
Michael Jordan would just dunk on him anyways. So
I don't know, Shaggy. If you give him some Scooby Snacks, then maybe he'll show you something.
Yeah, he'd probably do some cartoon ass shit and like end up on top of the hoop by doing like backflips.
He has a better waifu. I mean, he is Velma, so.
Velma.
Have you seen the Shadman Velma thing?
Shadman Velma? Velma? No, yeah. I've never seen that. Never seen that.
Do you know who Shadman is, Squilla?
I've never
Let's not go there.
I'm getting very distracted by Sloth's picture in this chat right now. His avatar is just so much cooler than everybody's. Just gonna say that.
Oh, thanks, Squilla.
Like, and no, it's really funny. Like, when I look at it, I know his mouth is closed, but like the part under his chin looks like he's like.
It looks like he's got a smug ass grin on his face.
I see it as like the part on his chin is like teeth, and he's like smiling. If I don't look at it for too long,
kind of looks like a douchey Sloth soul patch in a way.
Yeah. By the way, if you want to buy Sloth and Nuts T-shirt. Sloth&Nuts has t-shirts available for the next month. Buy them now.
Shameless plug from Squilla.
Signed by humans. Yeah.
Adam Barker had a better shirt.
When are we going to get more winter edgewear?
Dude, there's a vote right now on Twitter. Did you not participate in it?
Dude, I don't want a Squill Peach hoodie, all right?
Not hoodie, t-shirt.
Yeah, I'm talking winter edgewear. I need a hood. Right,
Everyone that doesn't agree that's in this chat with a peach, like, state your case.
I would rather go with the S.
I don't want a peach.
You just put one there anyways, though. Okay, I guess the S might be, like, a disagree. I see.
The smug would be a good one, too, but you mentioned you might not even keep that emote.
Savvy potato, that is the best thing I've seen ever. Right now, I've decided the last best thing wasn't as good as this. Why does the thing's face look like that? And how is it even?
I would like a squill jaw shirt. That'd be cool.
I want a Sin Lewd shirt.
When are we gonna get Edgelord fidget spinners?
I have never even owned a fidget spinner. I don't think I would feel safe giving people fidget spinners without even testing the product myself.
I have a fidget spinner, unironically.
I could imagine you having two fidget spinners and you're spinning them on either finger when you walk into a room at any time.
Dude, I'm doing that right now.
Oh, Squilla, you'll be proud of this. I have Heelys.
Okay, that's good. If you've had Heelys as a kid, then you definitely have like lived to the
No. I have Heelys now.
Oh, you're wearing them now?
No, I'm not wearing them right now, but I do have light up rainbow Heelys.
Some people might actually be jealous of that.
I'm jealous of it.
Some people, but not us.
oh boy.
Damn, Joey, did I just get a fire lit under my ass?
Roasted.
There's a fire there, and Sloth's avatar is like the reflection of it in his glasses.
Exactly. But did you guys have any more questions for Squilla?
No, I'm good.
Sloth?
When's the Squill Smug merch coming?
Well, I think Peach is technically won at this point. I think it has won. So, that will be as soon as I get the design. I need something that is the right sizing, and then I can actually like give estimates on international shipping, or like at least tell you guys about how that's going to work. But it'll be ready like at any point in time. I can do it right after I have the right sizing for the art, and then.
And I just want you to know, I'm wearing my Squill hoodie right now. I only felt it was appropriate.
You're talking about the one that was like the recent one, right? Like
It's the one of you and some random waifu chilling at the bonfire.
Okay, yeah, that's that one they made way better than the first one that I did.
Like, I don't think I've seen the first one you did, but I like this one a lot.
First one was like a rectum mode. It was like dude with like little dizzy things on his head. But and, like, the fabric was so much worse on that compared.
Who did the art for that one again? Was that Carson?
For the one that you have?
Yeah.
That was Yoam Connor, if you ever seen the chat. He did.
Okay,
he did
Connor.
That,
but... That's why I got the name also mixed up.
He also did the art for, like, my banner as well.
Right on.
Which is the same thing.
Before we end, I am running the first Absolver tournament that has a cash prize tomorrow at 12 p.m. Central Time on my channel. So if any of you guys care about Absolver, you should be there. It'll be really cool.
Wow, what a sellout. I can't believe he sold out.
Dude, he's plugging his merch. He's plugging his tournament. What a guy.
Wow. Saying things that are promotional in 2K17. What's the cash prize? Like,
it's $50 for first place, $30 for second, and $20 for third.
That's actually a really good deal that you're doing that. Wow. And who's in the tournament?
Because there's only like five who's people in the that tournament? Play
a I can give you the bracket. I'll post the challenge in chat.
Challenge. Okay.
Is there anybody that like have streamed the game, or is it just like people that are players that are part of the community?
Yes. Eclipt, oh. Connor J, Ponce and Faraz and Grey Maiden have all streamed it.
Wait, Faraz is in your tournament?
Yeah, Faraz is in the tournament tomorrow.
Okay, Eclipt, Ponce, and Grey Maiden. No, I'm definitely not even, like, I don't have a chance of winning.
Oh, man. Well, at least you got some good turnout. You got some good players in the bracket from what I'm seeing. Well, that'll be fun.
Who do you think's going to win? What's your prediction for the winner, if you had to pick?
I don't know if... Okay, fine. Just because it's you, Skwilla. If I had to guess, I would say that of all of the people that I have fought, because I've fought everyone who is playing except for like the random people I've never heard of before, I would say Connor J would be most likely to take it.
No way, Connor J.
Sorry.
Wow, that was really cool. Still.
I was just waiting for that, man. I was just waiting for the setup. I knew you'd say Connor J. Cringe.
And while we're on the topic of shameless self-promotion, go ahead and drop a Twitter link for the podcast in chat.
That's not even really self-promotion. This is you're streaming it on the account anyways. Like, that's just like
follow our
shit.
Twitter so you can keep up to date with future podcasts. Next week we have on Frosted Caribou, correct?
Yeah, I was actually going to suggest that we raid her because she's streaming right now.
Yeah, you got it. So,
wow, I'm not raiding in 2K17 when I'm playing a game. I wanted to get the views, even though I hosted you. But
Skwilla, we all know that you need the views.
I do, man. So- I need probably at least 10 more and then I'll be happy.
You need the 30 views.
10 more views and you might get partnered, 30. Dude.
Dude, I might get partnered twice. I might get a second sub button. That's been the dream.
Yep.
Dude, you might get affiliate. Oh my god.
Yo, if I could reverse engineer affiliate ship from partnership, that'd be amazing.
Oh, that is something I wanted to ask before we end. What do you think about the affiliate program?
I think it's good. And the only thing that I am worried about is the availability of partnership from the implications of affiliate ship.
What do you mean?
Like, I don't know if affiliates existing makes it harder for partnership to be given because
I assume it does.
Because of the amount of, amount of people that are being given permissions to, you know, monetize their content. I don't know if they're going to want to just push the idea away that those people will, you know, become partners because it is definitely, I can see it being motivational. There's a lot of positives to it, but I just hope it doesn't hurt someone's chance of becoming partnered, or I hope it doesn't make it harder unless it was already headed in that direction and there's nothing you can do. But me and Sloth, we were talking about that earlier, and it's an interesting kind of thing because it's just like a product of everything evolving over time as well. And just the amount of like hype around the platform and the more people, you know, harder things get and the way that things go with all the new things they introduce. But what me and Sloth were talking about that might be the most important thing to mention for anyone that's a streamer in chat right now as well, that is like either up and coming or maybe they're newer or whatever the case, I think they need to make tools that are easier. It makes it easier to find smaller channels that wouldn't really have much influence otherwise in any way, really. And Sloth actually mentioned that. He mentioned that there it would be cool if there's like a search kind of tool or a breakdown of, you know, kind of tiering people off or whatever the case. And I was even saying front page for affiliates instead of partner spotlight. Affiliate spotlight would be interesting if the person that qualified for it was able to handle it, and it did, and they knew that it could have implications of like there's going to be an inflation and it might go away a little bit, you know, so you're not going to always just be like, let's say you weren't used to having like more than, I don't know, like 30-40 viewers, and like then you have like hundreds or even like 1,000 or more, and you're not used to that, like just so you know it's going to be, you know, for that time, and you got to just like kind of soak up the opportunity and like make some good connections out of it. That's what it's for. If they could handle that, I think that's a really good tool if they do that.
I felt change that should be made to affiliate status is I've said this a couple times before. I feel like the 3 sub tiers should only be available to partners. Like, I feel like affiliates shouldn't even have that option for $10, $25 subs. I think that should be a partner exclusive thing. And affiliates should only have that $5 sub, but have 3 emotes available for it. Because I don't know. Because subbing to someone for $10 for 2 emotes is a bit much, in my opinion. Or even 25 for 3 emotes. Like, come on.
But think about how they're capitalizing on it.
No, and I know there's still people who are going to do it, and they want the money. But...
yeah, they're gonna capitalize on it from a business standpoint. It makes more sense to do it the way they did, and then no one's gonna sit there and complain like the opposite of what you're proposing. That, oh, you know, I can't get $10 and $25 subs. Like, why aren't I cool? You know, like it gives some similarity, I guess, between
your privileges. I remember when the affiliates first rolled out, a lot of people were complaining like, oh, I worked my ass off for partnership, and now all these plebs have sub buttons, like. It'd just be a way to differentiate and make partners feel better about themselves, I guess.
The people that were complaining about that when it came out probably look really stupid now, because it actually hasn't changed anything at all.
No, it definitely hasn't.
It hasn't changed anything at all, other than like my only worry of it, again, like certain people not being able to get partnered as easily is something that I'm concerned about. But I don't know. That might just be something inevitable anyways, and it's still a thing. Definitely it still exists, people get partnered. But there was a time where I noticed, before affiliate status was a thing, there was a time last year where I noticed a lot of people getting partnered in a short amount of time. Like they were almost just kind of making up for a lot of time where people were requesting, like they're putting in applications and they were just knocking out a bunch of stuff at the same time, and they just stopped, and I started not hearing about anybody getting partnered that I knew anymore. And it was like a significant thing, like where it was just a bundle and then it just went away. Like, and I know I'm not imagining that, like that definitely was a thing that had to have been a thing. And there's not as many people, if you go on social media and shit, there's not as many people retweeting or even like directly saying, hey, like I just got partnered, I'm excited and stuff. Have you noticed that as well?
Yeah, I have, actually.
Yeah, I've noticed it.
Yeah. So it's definitely, there's some degree of that. And that's, maybe a sign that they were, you know, and it could be they're just busy with other stuff, but yeah, hopefully it's still something that's fair in the way that if you meet requirements, you're given a fair review of your credibility and your, you know, your, the potential of you being an asset and, you know, being good for the opportunity and all that. So they wanted the money that GameWisp was getting. Yeah, and it's a similar thing with Bits as well. Like, they want to capitalize on, you know, taking away people from PayPal and, like, you know, like, they have their own fee, kind of like the fee of PayPal. But it gives something a little bit extra than just, like, kind of being, like, lifeless and stuff. There's, you know, there's, like, the alerts that are, or there's the emotes that are, like, you know, the animated ones. There's, like, the badge. There's something that makes someone feel inclusive somewhere along the line, other than it just being directly through that third-party service. So they definitely got, they definitely had a really good idea with that when it comes to, you know, making a feature work I think that it's a heavily utilized feature. And I've even noticed for things like GDQ, when it, like the last time I checked up on a GDQ that was on main page, just even for like a moment, I noticed they take bits for that as well now. And it's like, it works for a lot of stuff. So
I think that bits are actually nicer for the streamer because you don't have to worry about chargebacks with PayPal or credit card companies or anything like that. You just get the bits and that's it. And Twitch handles all the extra bullshit. They do take a pretty big cut for that, but I think that like if I had to pick between getting donations or bits of equal value, I would take bits. I mean, it takes longer to get them, but.
Well, it's also like the intent of the person purchasing them too. Like they wouldn't, someone's going to fuck around and try to give you a chargeback. It's not even going to try. So, or they're not even going to, they're probably not even going to waste the time to try to pull something shifty with it. So it's nice in that way. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
But yeah. And people have made interesting, like little things out of it too. Like it's kind of funny. I remember like when the Bit Cup was around and stuff, some people would like try something a little bit different than that, but a similar idea where they'd have like the Bit Cup animation without the cup and they would just like eat the bits. Like it would just pour into their mouth or pour into their pocket or something random. Like they would just use little silly things like that. And I think like that's another thing you can't do with PayPal. So it's like it gives something extra to it. I don't know, in a way. But yeah.
Well, it's been awesome having you on, Squilla. I think we're gonna go ahead call an end to the podcast right there.
Man, like what the hell? You're wasting my time. It's been like a total of like, wow, like 2 hours, man. What the fuck?
No, dude, we're just,
I got like
rude.
Important things to do in like Hollywood right now. I'm like late for my flight, even though it's a private jet. Just like, what the fuck?
But thank you
like,
for coming out.
Shoes that dined.
Thank you for coming out, everyone. Willa, your jet will be there for you shortly. I'm going to send you guys all on a little Raiderino tag along on that. Podcast will be uploaded on YouTube and SoundCloud by the end of the night. And links will be posted on our Twitter, which I'm going to drop in chat one more time for you guys. Thank you all for coming out. Next week, we've got Frosted Caribou, which is who I'm going to send you all on over to. And we will see you all next Friday. Have
also,
a good one, everyone.
Frosted Caribou is wearing one of my shirts on her stream right now. Just a side note.
Make sure you pick up your Sloth shirt right now. DBH, $29.99 USD.